We got up before dawn just to bring you
top of the morning from beautiful downtown Baltimore.
Hi to top of the morning.
The top of the morning to all of you.
Hi, top of the morning.
Top of the morning.
Welcome back, and as promised, we have Rosemary Ellen Guiley, author and paranormal investigator here with us, and she's written several books, and we're looking forward to talking to her about them. So welcome.
Thank you very much. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Yeah, this is very interesting material you have here.
It's never a dull day. I've been doing this full-time since the 1980s. I got interested in the paranormal as a kid, and I'm pursuing my passion. I am very intrigued by everything paranormal. I love to write. Love to investigate. So I've done 31 books now on just about everything in the paranormal you can think of.
Wow, that's pretty wild. Now, back in the 80s, I mean, what was it that made you so interested in this?
Well, it was more or less a merger of publishing interest and my personal interest. I've always been interested in the paranormal ever since I was a kid.
Sure.
But in the 1980s, we had an explosion of public interest in the paranormal.
Mm-hmm.
And suddenly published
with Ghostbusters?
Ghostbusters was part of it, Shirley MacLaine was part of it, the whole New Age movement.
Mm-hmm.
And so publishers became more interested in doing quality books on the paranormal,
mm-hmm.
not just what they would call occult books, which would be for a very narrow audience. So my skills as a writer and my knowledge of the paranormal came together and were quite an asset in publishing then.
Okay. So your first books were really to explain what was going on. Explain the paranormal, is that what it was?
That's right. My books are information intensive for people. I like to help people. I'm very interested in how people experience the paranormal and why, and how they integrate those experiences. So I've done a combination of encyclopedias, which are very information oriented. If you wanted to know something about the paranormal, these would be good books to consult. And then I have self-help books, like how to develop your intuition, how to improve your prayer life, how you can meditate, things like that, how to interpret your dreams, how to use the tarot, that are aimed at helping someone with their personal spiritual growth.
Sure.
Now, did you have your own personal paranormal experience?
I did, yes. In fact, I had many when I was a kid. There's psychic ability in my family, and I have developed my own psychic ability. I don't work as a psychic, so I don't call myself a psychic. But I think when you start investigating the paranormal, it does help you expand your own intuitive and psychic abilities. So I had experiences when I was a child of the invisible playmates, which I think were fairies. I had angel visitations. I learned how to experiment with my dreams, to dream the future, to send messages in dreams, things like that. And that increased as I got older because I went deeper and deeper into the paranormal. I really wanted to know.
Now, did you know your family had like psychic abilities when you were growing up as a child? Or
were your parents involved in this type of stuff?
My mother was, and I have an older sister who also has some ability. I didn't really learn a lot about my mother's experiences until I was in my early teens. And she had a lot of precognitive dreams and some visitations as well. And that fascinated me. That really got me interested in dreams. So I wanted to know more about it, like the idea that you could dream the future and it would really happen. It just really intrigued me. So I wanted to prove it to myself that this could really be the case.
Sure,
I'm very much a hands-on researcher.
Wow.
I like to know firsthand.
Uh-huh.
Wow. So you just published a book that came out, is that right?
I have a new book out, yes, that came out in Halloween, which is the third edition of the Encyclopedia of Ghosts and Spirits, and we have it here on the table.
Oh, okay.
This is one of my biggest sellers. It's a good book for people who are interested in the paranormal in general, because I talk about a lot of paranormal phenomena that people might experience. Almost everybody has what I call a ghost experience. You go someplace and you feel a presence, or maybe you have unusual. The Encyclopedia of Ghosts and Spirits is a good book for anyone who's interested in the paranormal, kind of at the beginner level, wanting to know more, because I cover a lot of explanations of paranormal phenomena. Many people have ghost experiences. That's where their entree to the paranormal begins. They might see something unusual, hear something, feel a presence, and wonder whether or not it was their imagination or was it real. Mm-hmm. And more often than not, it's a real experience, not the imagination. So I try to help people validate their experiences. Sometimes we have experiences that really challenge our worldviews, especially our religious beliefs. And I believe that it's important for people to have good information so that they can make their own decisions. I don't try to prove anything. I don't try to disprove anything. I don't try to interfere with people's worldviews. I just try to help them sort out their experiences so that they can make sense of things.
Yeah, oh, go ahead.
So in the encyclopedia here, right, let's say somebody has, you know, a dream. Is that what they would look up in the encyclopedia to try to get meaning to what that was?
Like flying or something like that?
What are they finding in the encyclopedia exactly?
I do cover dreams in almost all of my encyclopedias from particular standpoints. Like, for example, we do have dreams of ghosts. We have dreams where we're visited by ghosts. Mm-hmm. But if you want to understand your dreams, well, I've written 5 books on how to interpret your dreams, so that would be another separate kind of book. I have an encyclopedia on dreams that goes into how do you understand the symbols and the colors and the images.
We're here with Rosemary Ellen Guiley. We're having a great show talking about ghosts and spirits.
Yes, we are.
Encyclopedias.
Yes.
So anyways, you know, we're looking at these books, and these are fascinating. They really are. You have lots of different references. You even have references to some tarot cards in there.
Yes, and in fact, I use the tarot myself. I learned the tarot as a teenager. Mm-hmm. I was intrigued by the images on it. I paid attention to dreams my whole life, so the tarot seemed to me like a deck of dream cards, because you have to understand the symbols in them, just like dreams. It's a very good way to develop your intuition, to take a deck of cards with symbols on them, like the tarot, and then intuitively interpret and understand the symbols.
Okay, so the tarot cards, it's about interpreting them intuitively. You don't just, there's not like an encyclopedia that says this tarot card means this and this tarot card means this. What you're saying is that when you get a tarot card, you look at it and kind of interpret it? Is that?
It's a combination. Mm-hmm. I've written 3 books on the tarot, and I've done 2 book and deck sets with an artist. And if you buy a book on the tarot or a book and deck set, you'll get a little book that says, here are what the cards mean. Mm-hmm. They have kind of a basic meaning to them, each card. And beyond that, then your intuition speaks to you. So when you develop a lot of skill as a tarot reader, your understanding of the cards really goes beyond what the basic meaning is. So you're using your intuition to see them in kind of a holistic way related to the situation you're reading for.
Wow.
Hmm. Now, does your work as an author and a paranormal investigator, does that take you around the country? Do you travel a lot?
It does, Lil. I'm on the road a lot, in fact. I'm invited to speak at a lot of conferences. I work with a lot of groups on paranormal investigations, going into a haunted place, for example, doing an all-night vigil with equipment, and seeing what kind of results we get. Wow. So I'm often living out of a suitcase, but I find it fascinating. The people are wonderful. The situations are incredible. I just got back from Nevada, where I was out chasing UFOs for a while.
Wow.
I cover everything.
Sounds pretty interesting. You
what
know,
is that, Area 54?
Area 51.
51, that's it.
That's pretty wild.
Thank you, so, Studio 54.
So a lot of UFOs there, too.
Right.
So sometimes you're actually brought into a place to go into a place, and you said equipment. You bring equipment in there. And what are you doing? Can you give us an example of this? I mean,
sure. A lot of people are familiar with the show Ghost Hunters, and I know Jason Hawes and Grant Wilson, who are the 2 lead investigators on Ghost Hunters. I've done events with them. I'm not associated with the TV show, but I do occasional events with them, and other groups as well. So we have a variety of equipment. We have things that measure electromagnetic fields, temperature changes. We have infrared photography, night vision, thermal cams. Things that pick up sensitive changes in the environment which we are learning are associated with haunting phenomena. So we take the equipment in, we go to a place where paranormal activity has been reported, mm-hmm. and we set up our equipment, cameras to do surveillance, recorders to just run and hopefully catch disembodied voices. Mm-hmm. That's something called electronic voice phenomena. And you spend a lot of time sitting in vigil, because many phenomena are eyewitness. You experience them yourselves, your equipment may or may not pick up on them.
Wow.
Then we have to spend a lot of time digesting what we got through our equipment. Can we prove that a ghost is there? Well, no one's ever been able to prove mm-hmm. even that ghosts exist. But what we collect are a lot of evidence in support of paranormal phenomena, which I think is important. We do the same thing in live investigation. As I mentioned, I'm not on their TV show, but mm-hmm. I have done live investigations with them at haunted places. We've gone around to some of the biggest and most intriguing places in the country, like the Stanley Hotel, where The Shining was filmed, mm-hmm. the Queen Mary out in Long Beach, California, very haunted old cruise ship, Waverly Hills Sanatorium, which is a ruined tuberculosis sanatorium in Louisville, Kentucky. Other places of note, Lizzie Borden House. There are all kinds of places that have a lot of activity.
Well, when you say the Queen Mary is very haunted, what do you mean by that?
There are various kinds of ghosts there. Many of them are called residual imprints. That is, people who've lived or been on a place, maybe even died on a place, and there were people who died on the Queen Mary. They've left behind like an imprint memory. Mm-hmm. It's not really intelligent. It's like a video recording that does the same thing over and over again. Then there are intelligent ghosts that seem to be aware of the living and interact with them. For example, there's the ghost of a little child on Queen Mary. Her name is Jackie. She's actually been caught on tape crying and on electronic voice phenomenon recorder answering questions. Nobody really knows much about her background. There's a ghost of a seaman who was killed in an accident down in the engine room. He was crushed in a mechanical door. And he likes to tug on people's clothing. He has been seen as an apparition. Dozens and dozens of ghosts. The staterooms are haunted too.
Wow.
When you say that you've caught them on film, is that like with one of those infrared cameras that you were talking about earlier?
The best are thermal scan and infrared camera. Uh-huh. Sometimes people
and you can actually,
actually
see the shape of the ghost and you can see it doing things?
Well, what you usually get is a fleeting image that
uh-huh.
you can't explain naturally.
Okay.
And sometimes it's a blur, it might have a human shape,
uh-huh.
it might just be like a dark mass that
okay.
moves, and you cannot account for it naturally in terms of the play of light and shadows, for
mm-hmm.
example. You have to look at all possible natural explanations first before you go to a possible paranormal explanation.
Now, when you encounter a ghost, are there things as like good ghosts and bad ghosts, like Casper?
Nice ghosts, ghosts you want to stay away from?
Right.
There are angry ghosts and kind of mean ghosts. Most ghosts are not going to hurt people. They're rather benign.
Are there mean ghosts and good ghosts?
There are, yes.
Tell us
most
about.
Ghosts are not going to hurt anyone. They might
mm-hmm.
tug on your clothing, tap on your shoulder, pull your hair a bit, but there are mean ghosts. They're angry. And they seem to get riled up when people come in and investigate haunted places. People have been pushed and shoved, pinched. They might get a choking sensation. I don't know of any cases where people have been seriously injured by ghosts. It's more of a frightening experience. But yes, we do have them. Fortunately, they're a tiny minority of all hauntings.
How about now yourself? I mean, you've been in a lot of these haunted houses, so to say, with the equipment and trying to figure out what kind of activity is going on. Have you felt anything yourself? Have you felt a choking or a pinching or a pushing or anything like that you would say, there's a ghost that's messing with me right now?
Yes, indeed, I have many times because I've done hundreds of investigations.
Mm-hmm.
I have, I've had like small pushes. They seem to like to tug the back of your clothing. I've had that happen many
times.
Were
you scared?
Yeah, that's what I was
gonna. If you're startled, you can be scared, yes. There are places where I have felt kind of a negative energy and I haven't wanted to spend much time in. Sometimes it's prudent just to get out. I haven't run screaming from any place, not like the movies.
Yeah.
But sometimes you can be creeped out. Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, I got to get out of here.
Wow. So is there another book coming your way? You've written 31 books already.
Yes, indeed. I have several coming out this year. The third edition of my Encyclopedia of Witches and Witchcraft will be out this Halloween. Mm-hmm. That's now called the Encyclopedia of Witches, Witchcraft, and Wicca to reflect the growing Wiccan pagan religious movement. And I have two young adult books on the paranormal, one on witches, one on witches, one on ghosts, and one on vampires.
Wow.
Now, you started talking about witches, so what's the difference between witches and ghosts and paranormal investigator?
Well, the paranormal encompasses anything that we don't understand by our ordinary senses. It could be an angel visitation, seeing a fairy, knowing the future, experiencing a ghost, seeing Bigfoot, a UFO, all of those things.
Okay.
Witchcraft is a type of sorcery, and it has existed since our earliest history. We've mm-hmm. always understood that we have an ability to try and manipulate the natural forces.
Mm-hmm.
There are all kinds of magical ways that we do that, and witchcraft is one of them. It's considered a form of sorcery, that is, calling upon spirits, magical incantations, charms, using things to create a desired outcome, a spell, in other words.
The only thing I know about that is just, you know, they used to burn witches at the stake, like in Salem.
Yeah.
You know, that's all I ever really knew about witches.
Witches have not been liked throughout human history. They've always been associated anthropologically and sociologically with the negative side of magic. Magic in itself is neutral.
Mm-hmm.
It's a power. It's a force. So it becomes colored, good or bad, white or black, by how it's used. You can use magic for good, for example. Healing would be a form of good magic, you know, energy healing. In earlier times would have been considered white magic. But witches have been associated with malevolent things. Now there's a whole new religious movement since World War II where witchcraft has been recast as a good magic way, a spiritual path, a new religion. But in earlier times, yes, witches were hunted, they were persecuted. They were not burned in Salem, they were hung, and one was pressed to death. They burned them more in Europe, some in England, some in Scotland. During the Inquisition, witches were considered undesirables. And there were a lot of politics that went on in that too. It wasn't just being a witch, it was using witchcraft as a crime charge that could be used against people that the state or the church wanted to get rid of.
Now, when did people's attitudes start changing towards witches?
Very gradually, since about the 1950s. England had laws against witchcraft on the books up until 1951. And the laws had gotten less severe over time. That is, witches weren't necessarily automatically sentenced to death. They might be imprisoned.
Mm-hmm.
But in 1951, that law was repealed. So you could be open about being a witch.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there were lots of people who had learned kind of witchy ways from family traditions, you know, spell casting and ways of healing, a little bit of folk magic mixed in with pagan lore and that sort of thing. And so it was then okay to be open about that legally. And so we had a renaissance of interest in witchcraft that took shape as a new religious path.
We ever had any laws in America about that like they had in Europe or no?
Well, most of the laws in America dealt with witchcraft was defined as something that was divination. You know, there are lots of laws in America against fortune telling, for
mm-hmm.
example. And even in modern times, even in the 70s, people who did fortune telling professionally as a witch or whatever, could be arrested and charged
oh, really?
With crime. Yes.
Because wow. now it's a common thing. I mean,
it is
if
a
you go to any
now.
Beach, you
yeah,
have
palm
the,
readers.
Yeah, all
yeah.
over the
yeah.
place.
Those have been loosened up quite a bit.
Mm-hmm.
But in the new wave of witchcraft that came out of England in the 1950s, even up to the 1970s, people in America who called themselves witches and were doing card readings and things like that, if communities didn't like it, they could use very old laws against that on the books.
Is voodoo considered witchcraft?
Well, in a way you could say. Voodoo is actually a religious path, mm-hmm. and it involves magic, it involves calling on the spirits, mm-hmm. and spell casting, using things like images, dolls, sympathetic magic to do spell casting. So in a way that would be considered witchcraft. One of the things, confusing things that people don't understand about witchcraft is that the Inquisition associated it with devil worship. Mm-hmm. That's how witches were persecuted. Heretics were devil worshippers, and when the church enabled inquisitors to use witchcraft as a charge against heretics, that made witchcraft devil worshippers. Mm-hmm. And witchcraft has been about magic, spell casting, not about worshiping the devil. So people have this association that witches are all in league with the devil, and the media has reinforced that. Mm-hmm. And actually, that's not true. It's witchcraft is a form of magic.
Mm. Wow.
Okay, so was this crime against women? Women?
Yeah. I mean, were they going after all the women?
There were a lot of women who were killed, but what the church was after was wiping out heresy. Mm-hmm. Enemies of the church. They were really interested mostly in religious sects that threatened the domination of the church. Now, by the 1400s, they sort of landed on a very unique tool to wipe out the heretics, and that was to make witchcraft a crime of heresy. Mm-hmm. It was very difficult to disprove. You could trump up almost any charge of witchcraft against a heretic, mm-hmm. and pretty much condemn them to life in prison or to death. In this whole push for witchcraft as a heresy, a lot of people got caught up in that, men as well as women. Noble people, wealthy people, poor people, social outcasts, probably more women than men were executed because most of the village healers, the village spellcasters were women rather than men. But it wasn't a campaign against women per se. It was a campaign against the heretics. And some of the mass burnings, for example, they were the products of mass hysteria. People were tortured until they confessed, and then they were tortured to name accomplices. There were demonologists who were zealots about eradicating the influence of the devil. They really believed that the devil was afoot in the land. So there were cases of innocent people being swept up mass witchcraft cases. And then in certain areas in Europe, especially in France, after the Protestant Reformation, there were battles between the Protestants and the Catholics. Mm-hmm. So it was religious politics that got involved.
Wow.
The Inquisition is really a complex time in our history, and it lasted for several hundred years.
Sounds like it.
I've done a lot of research in Salem, and Salem is our witch holocaust, more or less. It was, it was the epitome of persecution. There were lots of witch trials in the colonies in the 16 and 1700s, but it just really got out of hand with hysteria in Salem, and we had innocent people who were hung. They lost their property. This was another terrible law that we saw in America and England and Europe as well, that if you were convicted of being a witch, you and your family lost all your property rights.
Wow.
It all went to the state.
Wow. Oh, that's terrible.
That really is terrible. We're having a fantastic show here. So let me get this straight. You also have books on vampires, is that correct?
That's right.
Vampires and werewolves?
Vampires and werewolves.
I've done three books, including an encyclopedia. I must say that out of all the topics I've done, I find some of the folklore about vampires the most intriguing. Mm-hmm. People ask me what's my favorite topic. It's really hard to choose sometimes because all these areas are so fascinating. But the vampire folklore is particularly bizarre.
Well, yeah, it is. Now, vampires and witches seem so different. I mean, they're not connected, are they?
Actually, there are living people in various cultures that would be called vampire witches.
Really?
There's a
lot of Transylvania,
Eastern Europe especially. There's a lot of blurring of the boundaries in the paranormal. For example, people with inborn magical powers might be called a witch, a sorcerer. In some areas, they might be called vampire or vampire witch. Vampires are not Tom Cruise as the vampire Lestat. They're not even Count Dracula, but they really do exist.
Hmm.
You believe that?
I do, absolutely. Mm-hmm. The basic definition from Eastern Europe of a vampire is the restless dead. Someone who doesn't quite make the transition into the afterlife and comes back into the realm of the living to pester people. They want food, they want to enjoy food again, they want to enjoy sex again, they're angry they're dead. These are all reasons given in cases that have been documented throughout time. And so they take from the living. They take energy, they take the life force, they take happiness that's symbolized in the blood, in your health. Epidemics, for example, were blamed on vampires. And this is a real phenomenon that's actually been documented around the world. They might not always be called vampires, but they do the same thing. You see, the vampire is not someone who gets turned by ingesting blood and walks around in a reanimated corpse and lives forever and is gorgeous and wealthy. That's kind of a
fiction. Movies.
That's the movies.
That's the movies.
But there are living people who call themselves vampires too, because they need to take something energy-wise from the living. And we have a whole vampire subculture today of blood drinkers and energy takers
really?
Who call themselves vampires.
Wow, that's bizarre.
It really is. That is really bizarre. So, so
but
when
they're living, not dead.
Yeah. Well, as long as they're not my next door neighbor.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking too. Exactly.
Rosemary, it's been wonderful chatting with you.
Yeah. This has been very interesting.
Thank you very much.
Interesting.
Yeah. So, any last thoughts for our viewing audience out there?
I encourage exploration of the paranormal. Mm-hmm. Actually, paranormal is really part of our ordinary reality. It just doesn't quite fit into our definitions of ordinary reality. But everyone has paranormal experiences. Mm-hmm. And I think the more we understand about them, the more we kind of push out the boundaries of our own consciousness. It's part of a very big picture. I have a website that I have a library of articles on. I invite people to browse. And that's Visionary Living, visionaryliving.com, mm-hmm. www.visionaryliving.com. I can also be found on MySpace. A lot of people love MySpace. Mm-hmm. And if you go to MySpace and just plug in my name, Rosemary Ellen Guiley, you'll get my page there too.
All right. I'll send you a friend request.
Thank you.
Now how about the books? Can people buy your books on the website?
I do have a lot of my books posted on the website. Mm-hmm. They're also available on Amazon.com, Barnes & Noble, Borders.
So they just put in your name, your books will come up.
If you put my name in, Google my name, mm-hmm. You'll get a lot of reviews on my books, places to buy my books, and commentaries, that sort of thing.
And what about public appearances?
I have a calendar on my website that lists all of my upcoming public appearances.
It's amazing. How many books have you written? You said 30?
31 and counting.
31
wow.
books. And you're writing books right now, right?
Yes, I am. I've always
Two
got
more books. Wow.
I've always got several in the works.
Uh-huh. So you do quite a bit of writing. That's pretty intense.
I also write magazine articles. I had a career as a journalist uh-huh. before I became an author. I was a newspaper and magazine writer and editor. Mm-hmm. And I still have major jobs with magazines.
Oh, really?
I'm a columnist for TAPS Para Magazine.
Mm-hmm. TAPS Para Magazine?
TAPS
so it's the paranormal?
Yes.
Okay.
TAPS is the Atlantic Paranormal Society. Uh-huh. That's the organization for the ghost hunters uh-huh. that's so popular on the Sci-Fi Channel.
Got it.
I'm a columnist, and my column is called, predictably, Rosemary's Baby. And I talk about different aspects of the paranormal and paranormal mm-hmm. investigation. And I have been, since 1991, an editor of Fate magazine, mm-hmm. which is the oldest continuously published magazine on the paranormal since 1948.
Wow. Wow. So you're quite busy writing away.
I am. And I also write for the Global Intelligencer, which is an online magazine. I've written for Atlantis Rising, Dreamtime, a lot of publications on different aspects of paranormal and spiritual.
That's
wow.
awesome. You're talented.
We should be asking you, what don't you do? You have two big chocolate chip cookies.
I usually buy those.
Chips Ahoy.
Well, I tell people that I cover everything in the paranormal A to Z, and that's angels, the zombies, and everything in between. I'm interested in the light and the dark because it's all one big picture. Everything fits together. I have insatiable curiosity, and that's why I just like to delve into everything.
Yeah, but doesn't the dark scare you, like all the evil stuff?
I think it's important to understand the dark side. When we let our fears get dominant, then we have trouble with the paranormal. Mm-hmm. Actually, once you look at what the dark side represents, it becomes a lot less scary. It's the unknown. It's the misunderstood. And I think it's important.